Jennifer Lopez ventures into a killer's subconscious.
I've never seen anything like this on film before.
And crashes the gates of a madman's inner sanctum.
I remember thinking, oh, I don't like this.
We learn the methods to making a sociopath.
Nobody knew exactly what I was going to look like.
And experience life trapped inside a nightmarish fantasy.
Here I am dressed like this big queen, and I'm torturing Vince Vaughn.
So I was like, oh God, I'm not going to be able to sleep working on this movie.
We meet the creator of this visually stunning thriller.
I think the look is quite original.
And go behind the scenes of a film that pushes the limits of science fiction.
It's a completely different take on visuals or effects.
Up next, E takes a riveting mind trip into the cell.
We're not going to Disneyland.
There's a chance of a confession, yeah. And there's things that he's done that show a need for disclosure. He hasn't had a sympathetic ear. He wants someone to listen, to try and understand him.
The sci-fi suspense film, The Cell, tells the story of a young psychologist experimenting with a radical new therapy.
The FBI comes to her and finds out that there's this therapy and this experiment going on. And they have a serial killer who's in a coma, who's in a catatonic state, who is schizophrenic, like the patient she's working with, and they ask her if there's any way that she can go into his mind to help find this last victim.
Vincent D'Onofrio plays the comatose serial killer, as well as the many characters haunting his own subconscious.
I think that my character is, in a way, trapped in himself. He's in a kind of, his brain is a kind of cell, and he's boxed in, and she enters that.
Vince Vaughn plays the risk-taking FBI agent who is desperate to locate the killer's victim.
He's a guy that cares very much about finding this girl, and that's all that's on his mind, any consequences that might come from his approach to doing so. He's important to him. You know, he's a guy within a system trying to do his best to solve the case and not really make friends.
The gruesome subject matter made some cast members wary of signing on to the project.
I was reluctant to do another... do a serial killer type film because there's been a few made and they've been done well, and I'm not sure that it needs to be told anymore. You know, but I met the director, and I don't know if you've ever met this guy, Tarth Sem. He's quite an amazing guy, you know. If you've seen the film, he's obviously a visual artist. But he's more than that. He's got an amazing intellect, and I think he's a good storyteller. And the ideas that he had and how he wanted to let me play a bit and he has the sense of a collaborative effort. You know, he really convinced me, basically, to do it. So I was there.
It's a thriller. On page, it would read like something like Silence of the Lambs, you know. If it has a nice pace, the movie goes well, and if it's exciting and this stuff. But the dream aspect of it left so much open creatively and open to Tarzan's imagination that he could put in whatever he wanted. And when he first showed me the images, I was like, oh, God, I'm not going to be able to sleep working on this movie.
I knew that it would be sort of a visual journey, but not kind of in a traditional effects way. This stuff is almost more like paintings and composition and otherwise. So for me, I was just interested sort of in being a part of that.
Being part of this psychological thriller posed some challenges for the cast.
What was the most difficult aspect of the film?
On the set, it was a really like quiet, somber mood, you know, and I'm kind of a peppy, happy person, you know, and I like to joke around and goof around, but it kept me in that kind of mood, which was kind of difficult for me, you know, to snap out of it later.
Probably the most challenging thing is just to kind of be able to keep your energy up. Whenever you're doing a film like this, it's pretty demanding hours-wise, and you sort of work around what's easier for effects and that sort of thing. So a lot of it becomes just sort of being able to stay focused. It's almost like running a marathon. Because there's so much time waiting to get sets or camera positions correct because that's kind of what you're trying to accomplish with it. So that's probably the hardest part of it.
You don't like what you do?
I like it better than my old job. I used to be an attorney. I was a prosecutor.
What happened?
I had a case. This little girl was molested. And because because of this one tiny piece of evidence that was tainted, he walked. After that, I left the DA and joined the FBI. Maybe I just tried to catch him.
Till now.
After the break, Jennifer hangs out on the set.
The physical stuff is always fun for me.
And gets to know the other actors.
I didn't approach him, he didn't approach me.
Plus, what it's like to enter the mind of a serial killer.
When I go home at night, you know, I have like weird dreams.
Are you sure?
In the psycho-thriller The Cell, Jennifer Lopez plays a therapist who journeys into the mind of a killer.
I thought it was going to be a little more intense than it actually wound up being because there was so much fantasy in it that it was hard to just, it was more reacting to me as opposed to acting.
But shooting the stunts was nothing but a thing for this former fly girl.
I was used to run, I was into sports when I was young and everything, and I was a dancer, so like the physical stuff, is always fun for me. It's not like, oh God, I have to run today, or I have to get hooked up to the thing that's gonna make me fall, rig thing. You know, it's all good for me. It's not really a big deal.
What was it like doing the wire work and scenes of the glass box? That was an interesting.
You know what? That's one of the images that stayed with me most of all. I don't know why. When I fell out of the box and then I just kind of hit, you know, whatever it was, water or whatever. I mean, it's open to interpretation, which is what's great about some of the movie too, but to me it just seems like she just hit water and just kind of floated, and the hair and the dress, and it's just like, and the way it stops, it's amazing. Yeah, and I did do a lot of that wire work, just falling and flipping over, you know, they put you on and I was like, what part is this? You know, because I never knew what I was doing, because a lot of it, like I said, was just reacting for me.
What is great about her was that she would sit down and ask me a take on something, and if she had a particular point of view, I would give a particular point of view, and she almost invariably would go with what I was suggesting, not half-half. She would just go with what I wanted. She was so trusting in that area that it was just, I better tell her the right thing, because she would just go 100% in my thing. She's actually really attentive for that.
She goes, yeah, you're falling out of the box, and then you hit water, so it's just like you're falling forever. And I go, okay. And I look down, or am I falling up? You know, I didn't know what to expect, because you just, a lot of times you would flip it, and he goes, no, you're falling and you're flipping over and everything. So he's like, if you feel comfortable, flip over. So it's one of those rigs that you kind of just suspend, and then you want to fall back or forward or whatever. It's fun.
There's those scenes where you're suspended in that red, very stylized suit, as is Vincent. What was that experience like for you?
We didn't do all of that though. Sometimes a suit just be hanging there. You know what I mean? Too much. But those suits, we called them the lobster suits. They were a lot. In a thick rubber like this. Pull them on, and they had booties and handies and head, yeah, everything. It was a lot.
They were made of rubber about that thick, and you couldn't, it was impossible to walk in them. And you just took them off and you were just soaking wet with the sweat.
And they didn't appear to have a fly.
No. No, once you were in, that was it. So you better plan your day properly.
I went in to get a cast made, and they put the things around, they do it like that, and you can't move. That's not fun for anyone.
Mm-mm.
But you go through it, don't you? Because you care about the process. Then on the actual day, they put you in the suit and they hang you by the stuff. Is it interesting for a couple of seconds? Sure. And then you want out of it because you want to have your freedom to go get a snack or use the restroom, whatever it is. You know what I mean? And I'm sorry to bring you down, and I'm sorry to bring the show down, but I just got to be honest with you. That's my style.
You're kind of a smartass, and I like that.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Seriously. Because if I do that, in a way, I hurt myself. You know what I mean? In a way, that means that I'm not feeling right. Seriously. I'm only a mirror. I can only reflect what I get off of you, Steve. That's all I'm doing.
The rubber suits were just a sample of the eccentric wardrobe.
What about Jennifer had some pretty outlandish costumes to wear, and you have to interact with her.
It seems strange, but I guess, you know, after a while, it did seem strange, but for my character, I think for him it was odd as well. I think that he, Tucker kind of used that in his kind of thing, going, okay, I know I'm in a dream reality, whatever. This stuff isn't real, you know, it's kind of his approach. So it kind of helped, I guess, for that was concerned. But sometimes you do step back and go, you know, everyone's going along with this, like it's not that big of a deal, but really Jennifer's in this weird costume and the intestines coming out over here. I mean, you do have those moments. You know?
Vince was great. He's
boy, is he tall.
Isn't he?
Yeah.
Did you see the shoes I had to wear in this movie?
I didn't.
They were like this. They're like big platformy. And I was like, please, these guys, they kill me right now. He's tall and so is Vincent D'Onofrio. They're both very tall. But he was great. Very charming, you know, nice guy. Like, Lopez, what's up? What are you doing? Not anything. You know, I'm standing there with a big red ponytail, whatever. Really weird.
When we come back, Vincent D'Onofrio makes his startling appearance.
The first day he went out and he put his wig on and he came out and got creepy.
And Jennifer follows suit.
I'd be like, I have to wear that?
Want to know what Jennifer likes to wear? Check out the Jennifer Lopez Q&A on E! Online.
There is a girl that is missing. Her name is Julia Hickson. He is the only one that knows where she is.
In the sci-fi thriller, The Cell, Vincent D'Onofrio plays a serial killer, as well as the monsters who torment his subconscious.
You know, you can't take yourself too seriously. You have to try and get away in a serious manner of what you're trying to do. But, you know, here I am dressed like this big queen, and I'm torturing Vince Vaughn, you know, I'm pulling his intestines out, and I mean, you know, it's absurd, so you have to laugh at it.
Actually, the most intense scene of all of them was in the dream sequence, now that I think about it, which was the scene where he has the girl in the bathtub and I enter into his mind and he's there with his first victim. That was kind of freaky between the two of us. I remember thinking, oh, I don't like this.
Where is Julia Hickson?
No man.
There needed to be a mood on set, a very fragile kind of mood on set. And I think that Jennifer was conscious of that. I was conscious of it. And the set was always very quiet when we approached these scenes, all of them between Jennifer and I. I was doing things that nobody had seen. You know, nobody knew what I was going to do when I came onto set. I mean, nobody knew exactly what I was going to look like. So the minute I would walk onto set and start doing what I was doing, there was a kind of awe-ness of what these designers had actually produced and what I was trying to execute. So anyway, and then this kind of air between Jennifer and I, as I said, was very fragile. It was like glass almost. I mean, it could have broken if it was disrupted in any way. And we approached each scene like that. It was quite interesting.
It was an instinct on both our parts. Like, I didn't approach him, he didn't approach me, you know? And I just thought to myself, he's in character a lot. And it sounds like, kind of scary. Just a little scary on his head with all those things all over him, you know? So, we just kept our distance, and it turned out to be really good for the characters, you know? And I guess it was just, like I said, an instinct on my part and on his part to just keep far away from each other so we could have that tension in the air.
D'Onofrio, I think, is the actor's actor. I mean, they didn't know him to say anything more. It's just everything that he had to do, he didn't have to say a single word. In all the parts that we were filming earlier, it was all about body language. And the first day he went out and he put this wig on and he came out and got creepy. It was just perfect from right there.
the most challenging thing about this film?
I think executing. I think, and I mean in the sense of approaching each scene with the director and thinking, you know, how the hell are we going to get away with this? You know, what are we going to do here?
What about the scenes where you're suspended? In the suit as well as from the back? How did they do
that? Well, it's kind of half and half. Half of it I did and half of it a double did. The double had to wear a harness completely over his body and then a prosthetic skin on top of that to mock my skin. And then the cables were attached to the harness beneath the skin in this trickery of having it stretch. I had to wear like half of that and be suspended from with just laying my torso laying on a board and my legs kind of stretched out freely to fake being suspended there. But we were in fact both suspended for a long time, and to have to act that particular scene was quite uncomfortable.
Vincent wasn't the only cast member challenged by the costumes.
Aiko Ishioka did the costume. I'm trying to get her name right all day. I think that's right. And she's the same woman who won the Oscar, I believe, for Bram Stoker's Dracula, you know. And she was just amazing. The idea she would come up with, you know, she'd make these drawings, and I'd be like, I have to wear that? You know, with this black armor and that steel kind of bondage type thing where you're just, like, trapped, like you're inside a cage. It was really cool, really creative.
She's lost. She thinks this is real.
Coming up, Inside the Killer's Mind.
It's not going to be a comfortable place.
But she's made contact.
Yes. She's gone very deep into his world. Time's too far.
Cold.
That could be dangerous.
What are you talking about?
Well, if she came to believe that Starger's world is real, then theoretically her mind could convince her body that anything that was done to it there dying. Of the old wives' tale, you die in your dream, you die in your life.
Playing the lead in the sci-fi thriller The Cell made it hard for actress Jennifer Lopez to leave her work on the set.
Once she goes into the serial killer's mind, she's drawn into a very dark world, the mind of someone who actually, you know, kills somebody and bleaches them and does disgusting things to them, and it's a totally different thing, so it's really shocking to her at first. And so for me to play that, I mean, even me, and when I go home at night, you know, I have like weird dreams, but it also made me more aware of my dreams.
Because I didn't know anything about the movie, really, it's like, wow, where is this taking us? Where was that shot?
Africa, in Namibia, out in the desert, way, way, way out. And it took us forever to get there.
Was it hot?
It was so hot, but I love the heat, I don't care. I loved it. I loved my tent. They had me a tent. They had a fan. So cute. Everybody else hated it. It was too hot for them.
And is that you trudging up the sand dunes?
It's me trudging up the sand dunes. And I didn't ride the horse, though.
Didn't want to?
I'm not a good horse rider. This way, he keeps up.
What aspects of your character do you share with the woman you play?
And this character for me. She was very passionate and driven and, you know, almost like a sacrificial lamb. You know what I mean? The type of person who wants to save somebody, even if it's at her own expense. And that was one of the things that drew me to the character in the first place. Just that interesting aspect. I mean, I'm passionate. I'm driven about what I do. But would I sacrifice my own health and well-being for it? I don't know. You know, maybe, but I don't know. And that was really interesting to me.
Thanks for watching. Join us next week as we go behind the scenes. Rare.